everybody. Chatting away. Hiya, over there. Hello, 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 hello. How nice to see you all on such a warm evening. I'm Miranda Sawyer, not Michael Palin, as you may have guessed. I feel slightly ludicrous doing an introduction for Michael Palin because he is so well known and so well loved, but it seems only polite, so I shall do it. Michael Palin has been a fixture in our national conversation for many years now. He started off reinventing British comedy from the late 1960s onwards with Monty Python. He managed to squeeze in an award-winning Hollywood career. He bashed out a few novels, a couple of children's books, a few plays, before entirely reinventing the British travelogue on television with his BBC travel series. He started off with Around the World in 80 Days in 1988, and since then has done Pole to Pole. There's so many I have to write them all down. Pole to Pole, Full Circle, Himalaya, Sahara, the list goes on. Anyway, his latest one is Brazil. In his travel documentaries, I think it's fair to say that he manages to combine charm with both experience and a curiosity that endears him to everybody that watches him. He's also, of course, from Sheffield. Yes, that's what I said. Should we just applaud Sheffield? Yeah. Hello for Sheffield. So, ladies and gentlemen, proof that nice guys sometimes finish first, here he is, Michael Palin.
Yeah, it's much easier when I was unknown.
It's shuffled off.
And nothing to live up to.
So I'm going to put this here just in case I need it. So I thought we could start off just really quickly with your life in Sheffield, because I read a recent Sunday Times piece in which you said growing up in Ranmore made you the person that you are. The quote was, it was an epic and dramatic place to live. This is a man who's been to the Himalayas.
Yeah.
Do you think it turns you into an explorer or a comedian?
Well, actually, both were there, interestingly, when I think back. And I mean, what I meant was that when I must have said something about it being an epic and dramatic place, I meant that that end of Sheffield was for somebody who couldn't afford to travel anywhere, as nobody could at that time. You know, a 6, 7, 8-year-old growing up to be able to go up to the Rivelin Valley and the crags and look down over this really quite dramatic Peak District landscape and, you know, go on bike rides and all that. I think I did have a feeling that actually, there was a sense of adventure to Sheffield that probably wouldn't be if I'd been from Leicester or something like that. I don't know. You're not from Leicester,
sorry,
are you?
No, I'm not from Leicester. Not from don't worry, Leicester.
I go through Leicester, and I think this is not quite as exciting as perhaps Sheffield was. So there was that element which appealed to my urge to sort of explore. It wasn't travelling, it was just exploration. And comedy was just a part of Sheffield life. I mean, you know, there's something about the way people talk up here.
You can all jump.
Very, very slowly. And you think it's quite boring, but actually, it's very, very funny in a very, very dry and understated way. And I used to hear this from the shops and all that, and I loved it. So it was a good place to have a laugh.
And there's a kind of a feeling about some of your travelogues, and indeed about you, which is a slight kind of boy's own adventurousness to it. And I wondered sometimes if you are kind of forced through circumstance, which many of us were when we were younger, not to travel, that you bring your old boy's own adventure to the area that you are, that you grow up in. So you're saying kind of, you know, you went up crags and you could see lots of different places. You're having an adventure almost in your own backyard. You didn't need to travel.
No. But it was a lot of it was the imagination. And I think that's where the comedy and the travel came together, because I had a very vivid imagination. So although I didn't travel abroad at that time, I did read all sorts of magazine books, any adventure story that was set anywhere in the world, like Biggles. You know, Biggles was always off somewhere, Gobi Desert and all that. And I could imagine myself there, and I read about explorers in the Amazon. Percy Fawcett was a big, I was very interested in him because he disappeared, believed eaten, in in the Amazon about 1928. And I thought, God, this is what a risk he must have taken, what a plucky guy. And of course, Captain Scott and all that. So I could, it wasn't just learning the facts and figures, it was actually, I was projecting myself into their lives and what it must have been like. And I think that was the same with, you know, I was quite good at acting, I suppose, at school. I wasn't good at very much, but acting I was quite good at. And that's another sort of thing, taking on another character. Yeah. I could have played Captain Scott or Percy Fawcett without really knowing much more about them other than where they'd been.
No risks of being eaten.
No, without risk of being eaten. I don't know if he was eaten. Funnily enough, on the Brazil series, we actually went very close to where where Percy Fawcett was believed to have been eaten.
Waved.
But I couldn't find anything. There was just a bill from the restaurant, and that was all.
So this is a documentary festival. I thought we should talk about your documentaries, although obviously we'll kind of talk about other stuff. I wanted
my chair
to
around like
so we can see everyone. I feel like I've got my back to you as well. Can you see through me? Not really. Do you want to move?
Yeah.
You all right? I'll go like that. Is that better? Can you see him? Okay, I'll just be like this, people. I'm lounging. Yes, right. They want to see you.
No. You can do that side. I'll do this side.
Hi. And what I wanted to start with, we have a clip here, and I know, because you've told us, that this was a particularly important visit for you. So shall we start with our, and we're going to wave at you, our South Pole clip.
At this point, all the world's lines of longitude converge on my toe caps. It's impossible to go further south than this. Every direction you go in will be north. At this point, I can actually walk right around the world in 8 seconds, as I will now demonstrate. It is the end of the world. It's also the end of our harebrained migration from north to south. I think the omens are telling us to stop. Just a while ago, the camera packed up because of the cold. And as you can tell, I'm beginning to pack up because of the cold too. It's minus 30 degrees centigrade here. With wind chill, that's about minus 50. We're also at an elevation of 9,000 feet. So there's altitude sickness to combat. But I think it's just that after 5.5 months on the road, the body is finally saying, pack it in.
When I was a boy in Sheffield, I dreamed of coming here, like my heroes, Scott and Amundsen. Now I am here, I want to celebrate. But it's not that easy. The US government doesn't encourage hospitality. While the scientists snuggle under warm blankets, we spend a bitter night, 4 to a tent. But I can think of no more fitting end to our pole-to-pole journey than to say, I'm glad we did it this way.
Very nice. It's quite interesting seeing that a bit again. I mean, it brings back all sorts of memories, mostly of pain. But I was very nervous of piece to camera I had to do at the pole, because this is really summing up the entire journey, which had taken us 4 or 5 months or something from the North Pole. And this was it, you know, I had to, and it was a very, very difficult circumstance. It looks fine there, but as I say, that the cameraman was very worried that, a 1 minute piece to camera, the camera might freeze up. He said, we'll just have a go and let's see how it works. So I did my bit, and at the end, I was really pleased. I was absolutely word perfect. I was really relaxed. It was absolutely fine. And the sound man said, I think you might want to do it again. And he was kind of grinning. And I'm grinning. It's minus 50. All you want to do is get into a tent or under the ice or into the American base or something like that. But he said, well, just have a listen. And I listened to it, and there was a bit where I said to camera this time rather than voice over, I remember, as a schoolboy in Sheffield, reading about the exploits of Scott and Amundsen under the bedclothes at night. And, you know, he said, this is it. Yeah. That's why they didn't take their wives, you see. Sorry.
Sorry, dear, just off for a bit of exploring.
Any girls going? No, it's all just chaps. Just chaps.
It's going to be hell out there.
Anyway, so he completely threw me, and I said, you're right, I suppose I should do it again. And I did another two or three takes, and everything went wrong immediately, as it does when you feel you've got something right, you know, and then you have to do it again, and all the horrors come in, and I start off by saying, I'm standing at 9,000 degrees above sea level. Oh, start again. So it was nice to see that, obviously, they managed to get it right in the end. And interestingly, put the bit about Scott and Amundsen on a voiceover rather than my straight-to-camera piece.
Yeah, they might have used the first one and just cut straight to it. I did notice, though, given your Scott and Amundsen under the bedclothes references, that you are staying four to a tent.
Yes, yeah.
You, presumably, especially after 5.5 months, you know each other very, very well. And one of the things I think about when, obviously, normally when I watch a documentary, if it's a good documentary, I'm taken away with the documentary. Yeah. But if you unpick it, one of the things that nobody really gets to see is the fact that you spend all this time with all these people. Yes. It might be referenced occasionally, but essentially that is a tough part of the job, surely.
Well, they probably feel the same about me.
And you're the nicest man in Britain. They
won't. It is. You've got to get the right mix of people. Yeah, absolutely. And that's essential. I think that's why, very early on, we found a group of people that we all enjoyed travelling for all the right reasons. Not the ooh-ah. Just we knew it was a job, but we wanted to do it. And the cameraman Nigel Meakin, who I've used on nearly all my series, is absolutely brilliant. And Nigel's quite a taciturn man, doesn't say a lot. And it's brilliant, we just get on with the job. He knows where I want to be, I know when I shouldn't be in shot and when he's going to take another shot. And that's really essential. And with directors, we've tried to use the same directors, tried to use the same sound guy. Because when you do get a team like that together and it works, it really, really is important. As you rightly say, you spend an awful lot of time with them. In fact, I think Nigel and I, at one time, did sit down and work out how many meals we'd had together on the longest shoot, which was Full Circle. And it was something like 857 meals we sat across from each other and eaten, you know.
Talking sweet.
That's more than I've had with my wife, I think, probably. So there you go. Yeah, the team is very important to me. And I think it's not a bit like Python as a team.
Yeah.
Once you get to know a group of people who produce good work,
You don't want to mess that up. It's like a band.
And sometimes it's not always so easy. The BBC are quite, they like to mix and match. They like to sort of, in my case, I managed to argue the point that I should work with the same people. But there was a feeling if you're having too good a time, that was a bad thing. this should be
stopped.
Yeah.
Yeah, you should send back tales of we all hate each other and then look
together.
Yes,
yes. That,
And at the South Pole as well, again, it's a beautiful shot. You know, the camera that you walk around, it's lovely. You get into your tent, and that's fine. But that's not actually what the South Pole was like after that epic journey to get there, which was very difficult at certain points, wasn't
it? Yeah, it's hard to sort of convey that. We flew into Antarctica and we went to a base called Patriot Hills, which is just a lot of tents. It's run by a venture network with the people running it. They take a few people out there. It's near the tallest mountain in Antarctica, and there are people who want to climb all the mountains of the highest mountains of all the continents. So they go to Mount Vincent there. And so weren't that many people, and that was great and really lovely and rather beautiful. And then we had to fly from there to the pole, and that's, as I say, going right so high up to the centre of the continent. And it turned out that we had a single-engined Cessna plane to get to the South Pole. And I remember saying to the guy, the pilot, you know, before, I said, is it, you know, it's going to be difficult flying in these conditions? He said, I don't know. I've not been to the pole before. And I said, but, you know, the plane, presumably the planes are going to withstand it. He said, I don't know. This plane's never been to the pole before either. So we were going in a plane that's never been to the South Pole with quite an elderly man, and I say that as a 70-year-old myself, quite an elderly man who'd never been to the South Pole himself. And I, fortunately, it wasn't until we came back from the pole that I learnt from one of the people who'd stayed behind at the base that he'd actually been seen drinking whiskey at 5 o'clock in the morning before we started. So there was all that going on. And I remember the plane took off and the door flew open. You know, not the main door, the door of the cockpit. He just slams the door and off we go. And it's at moments like that you do feel, a part of you feels this is really stupid and actually dangerous. And if something did happen, I would have no justification for having, gone through this. We live in a world of health and safety and all that. And this was absolutely, completely the opposite. At the same time, it's rather thrilling. Yeah. And it makes it's back to Biggles again.
Yeah.
We're having a Biggles-like adventure.
But then when you get to some places, I just wondered, because the South Pole, I mean, obviously, for anybody would be an amazing place to go to, but you had this epic journey, you get there. And is there ever a sense in those moments that you feel disappointed or not? It's not quite what you think?
Yeah. Yes, I mean, the South Pole was actually like that. It was great to get there. But actually, it's a dump. I mean, it is a dump. Literally a dump. A dump of all sorts of building equipment. Because basically, there's a base there called Scott Amundsen Base. And it's dug down underneath the ice, and it's run by the Americans, and it's got central heating and showers and people in their Bermuda shorts eating blueberry pie. And on the surface, it's minus 50 and cruel. There are lot of pallets of various bits of huts and all that sort of thing. It's like a sort of grubby old builder's yard. And so we had to point the camera the other way. Yeah. So I wasn't really able, I was quite disappointed, yeah. I wasn't able to really recapture the thrill that I, or capture the thrill I hoped I'd have. Whereas first time I saw the Victoria Falls was extraordinary, because I walked out from on the Zambian side and just looked over the falls. And there's no fence. You can walk right to the edge of this great 600-foot drop and the water crashing down. And that was just, absolutely extraordinary. So it depends. The South Pole was a bit of a disappointment.
Despite a beautiful piece to camera.
Well,
despite your beautiful piece to camera.
Yes, no, it was quite nice seeing that.
I've got another clip, because I thought we should talk about Brazil, it being your most recent. And I thought we should see you dancing, to be honest.
Why? Why? why inflict this on these good people?
It's nice. We also thought it's a large stage. We may do some dancing.
Yes, we can. Yeah. If you wish. Have you done capoeira? Oh, well, let's see.
Okay. Well, I can pretend.
Yeah.
Xangô já faz isso. Tá, tá, tá. Então, olha, quando você vem para capoeira, você já está bem flexível. Entende como você? Você já está. Eu estou conversando, você está indo. Isso aí, isso aí.
Okay.
Do you like dance?
Dance, yeah. Dance? Well, yeah.
Samba, vai.
I do my own version.
Sim, vai, aqui. Isso. Isso.
The Scottish bit.
Muito legal. Cadê as palmas, galera?
That's dance on.
Love the further round of applause. Yeah. That is obviously in a beautiful dance that you engaged in. But one of the things I wonder about when you're doing something like that is obviously in order to get that sequence or indeed to engage with that man, you just have to have no inhibitions at all, really. I mean, if you'd gone in and said, I can't dance, that would, we wouldn't have had the joy of that experience that we just had.
Yes, you're right. I mean, I kind of learnt about shedding inhibitions when we did Around the World in 80 Days, which was the first one. And you're right, really. It's silly to say, oh, sorry, I might look an idiot. And I did at one time try that But the director just says, oh, go on, do it.
But in Brazil, you go swimming with quite... Actually, it turned out later, I think, I understand that you found out with dolphins that are quite dangerous and you don't know. You just go in because you think they look pretty in pink.
Yes, yeah.
But, you know, I mean, there are plenty of presenters that perhaps would be more shy. I mean, you know, you go swimming, you dance, you have a conversation with kind of anybody that's given to you. And some people wouldn't do that. They would be a bit snotty about it.
No, I mean, sensible people they are. I just think that I sort of discovered, I'm sorry, going back to Around the World in 80 Days, that it was actually, I didn't know quite how to present a documentary, particularly a documentary like this that had no precedent. No one had done something like Around the World in 80 Days where you have a camera with you all the time.
Yep.
And I remember thinking, well, what if I'm just sort of having a shit or something like that? trying to get to bed. I mean, how intrusive is it going to be? So you can't have many inhibitions. But I remember it was on the third episode when we went across the Dow from Dubai to Bombay, and we were for 7 days in the hands of 18 Gujarati fishermen, only one of whom spoke English, and they were, you know, our life was in their hands for all our equipment and our technological know-how. We depended on these guys, and I felt ill and sick at one time, and I just remember doing a piece to camera one morning. I said, I just don't feel like doing anything. The director said, well, tell them you. How you feel? So I'm a whingy piece. I'm like, oh, no, I don't feel so ill, you know, I want to sit down. There's no chairs on this boat. I remember saying that. That's a chair. I love a chair. And by the time we got to Bombay, I realised that actually I was no longer sort of acting the Phileas Fogg character. I was just being me, reacting. And that's the way we went on. And actually what people liked at the end is when things go wrong, because you're an everyman and people expect when you travel that you're going to get ill.
But it's interesting, but they didn't necessarily before that. And at the very beginning of Around the World in 80 Days, which I kind of rewatched knowing that I was going to interview you, it's very actory. You are acting. You go and visit people in Lloyd's of London. You stay in Britain for like half an hour
of the programme.
And you're just kind of wandering around Lloyd's and going, well, you know, what about shipping? And then you go and meet Alan Wicker and you talk to him. And you kind of play and, you know, Terry Gilliam and Terry Jones wave you off. And it's very, it's quite stagey.
Yes, it was stagey, definitely, and quite conventional, that preparation. But then we, you know, it's just, I'm not justifying it. I'm just saying that we didn't know we were dealing with a new kind of documentary. And because it was Around the World in 80 Days, there's quite a bit in Around the World in 80 Days about him, his friends asking him to buy things and or bring things back to prove he's been away. So we went through all that cumbersome business. I was an actor. I mean, I'm an actor. I just finished doing A Fish Called Wanda. I thought, well, I've been hired because I'm an actor, so I better act this Phileas Fogg character. So I was half being the kind of idiot Englishman abroad. And as I say, that was the way I did it for the first two or three episodes until we got on that Dow.
Yeah, which is a very moving piece of film. It's actually really where the series starts taking off. It's very memorable.
Well, that was out of the comfort zone. All the rest, and you know, going on the Orient Express as we did at the beginning of Around the World in 80 Days. I mean, that's fairly conventional. It was quite good fun, but it was fairly conventional. You'd seen that before. But going on a Dow, which is not even the Dow we were supposed to go on, at some risk with the engine breaking down and, you know, all sorts of things, that was totally a new area for everybody.
Yep.
And that's, I realised, that's what made the series, that it really picked up at that point. In fact, it was re-reviewed, and the third, after it got some pretty bad reviews after the first programme, but someone re-reviewed it after after the third programme and said, actually, this is a bit different. This is getting a bit interesting. So you're right.
And then after, it's very interesting, because after that, when you go into your documentary, you're just straight in. You're just, we don't need a preliminary, because now we know what you know, and us as the audience know what you're about to do, really.
Or, yeah.
And do you then relish? I mean, is it that, you know, I'm sure this can't happen, but do you hope at some point that things are going to start going wrong? Because there is sometimes, yeah. You know, speaking as a journalist, sometimes if you're interviewing someone and it goes terribly wrong, you think, well, it'll make good copy. And there's part of you that thinks it might.
Oh, yeah.
Is good TV.
Yes. Oh, it's much more interesting if things are a bit unpredictable. Mm. I mean, the best thing is you do an interview with somebody and it turns out they've really got some, you know, something you've not prepared for at all. They come completely out of left field. And that's great, and they've got a certain axe to grind or whatever. Yes, it is. It's great when there are accidents along the way, or things just don't work out the way you'd expected, and you have to adapt, because you think on your feet, and you have to think very quickly and be quite nimble, and the entire crew has to as well. And you learn together. I mean, I remember it was just a sort of interesting example of how I work with Nigel, the cameraman, is that we were in a village in China, and it's a remote part of rural China. They'd never seen anyone from the West ever. So you go to this place and you go in across the fields, and there's this village. And of course, everyone's just looking like that. You don't know what's going to happen. And anyway, they work out a sort of sequence. So, you know, when we go in and Michael, if you just find your way over to that hut at the end there, and there the guys are going to be sitting preparing some food, okay? So that's what you're doing. And so we start filming, and of course they're all coming up to me and saying this, that and the other, and I'm looking around, I'm saying, this is quite amazing. I've never seen anything like this. And their relationship to me and all that. And there's Nigel with this quite heavy camera on his shoulder following me. I'm talking to people here, talking to people there, and I suddenly hear from Nigel under his breath, "Get inside the fucking hut!" and there you are, you see. It was just, I was thinking, I forgot we were making a documentary. And just thought, here I am, in this amazing place. The things you're not prepared for are by far the best. I really do like being taken by surprise, as it were.
Have you found that over the, it's now 25 years that you've been making these programs, and I notice in the Brazil one, when the first program, you have a lot in there now. You had about 16 different stories in there. You were traveling, you were hopping 500 miles here and then over here. And do you feel like you have to include more information? Are you asked to do that, or are you more prepared, or is it the way of the world that we need more information more quickly?
Well, something like Sahara or Himalaya was largely about a journey across parts of the world that were very difficult terrain, very few people there. So it's actually, that's your story, is how you get from A to B. You can have a sort of 2 days on a camel train without saying very much to anybody because there are very few people there. With Brazil, the journey itself was just not quite so easy because Brazil is a huge country, and how on earth do you do a journey which takes in the whole of the country? So what we decided to do was we had four shows, was do four separate sort of geographical and social parts of the country. So the northeast was one, and then you wouldn't take a journey down the northeast coast, then right up to the Amazon and down again. But if you wanted to see the northeast coast, which is really fascinating part of Brazil, and then you also want to see the Amazon, you had to make them into separate journeys. So the actual journey itself wasn't quite the story, and in Brazil too, the distances are so enormous. Yeah. And there just aren't many roads, really. You know, the roads are fairly boring. So you've got to fly, and flying you can't film because the camera's got to be packed away and all that. So there was a lot of flying which we couldn't film. And I in a sense, I missed some of the actual journey itself. I think we covered Brazil extraordinarily thoroughly. But it rather meant that we were doing one place with a story, another place with a story, another place with a story, and not really getting the nice train rides in between, or the camel rides, or you know, scrambling over the of the Himalaya.
Yeah, yeah.
And that was just Brazil itself.
And so would you yourself prefer, you prefer the journey one?
I think the journey is quite important. I mean, I never really was going to do another documentary, travel documentary after Around the World in 80 Days. I was just going to do it. There's a, someone asked me to at the BBC, and I said, well, I'll do that, and then I'll get back to making films, which I did. And I did a film which I'd written myself called American Friends, and I did GBH, which is a purely acting role with Alan Bleasdale. And yet, you know, then in the back of my mind was, what if we did another journey? As Jules Verne written, you know, something we could use. His other stories were sort of, you know, 20,000 Leagues Beneath the Sea and Journey to the Centre of the Earth, which would be, you know, uncomfortable, and the BBC wouldn't pay for the drilling required. So, in the back of our minds was to do another one, and it eventually turned into Pole to Pole, but we, you know, I wasn't really intending to do another documentary. But once we'd sort of, once we'd done Pole to Pole, which didn't have anything to do with Jules Verne, we couldn't hang it on any other story. It's just purely me travelling to remote parts of the world or not so remote parts of the world and reacting. And that worked as well in terms of audience and all that to as Around the World in 80 Days had. So suddenly we had this, it was very, very tempting. One could just take trips and make them fairly tough, but, you know, film them with our team and hope that there would be an audience each time. And there always was.
And you do, I mean, around the trips, not only do you make the trips and you make the programme, you write books, there are photography books, there's a lot of stuff. I mean, you were quite cross-platform very early on.
Cross-platform, I am indeed.
I was very impressed with that.
I feel that, and you pointed it out quite rightly.
But are you ever kind of issued diktats that you have to kind of tweet from the rainforest? Or
well, they did try at one time. I mean, the book I think is a really, that was part of the deal of Around the World in 80 Days, you could supply a book as well. And that's no hardship because I keep notes, slavishly when I'm traveling anyway, little things I see, I'll just note a little name down there. And you do see some wonderful things. What did I see in the Philippines? Just a name of a building. It was called the Immaculate Conception Funeral Parlour. I just thought, this has to be written down. And another lovely billboard on the train in India, and it said, Yugal and Sons, where fashion ends. that's really good. And then it was a little bit further on, about a few miles on, it said nothing, Yugal and Sons, trousering, suiting, life. Brilliant. So again, I had to write those things down. So I do write things down, and also the book doesn't have to be the same as the series, because when we finish the series, we come back, the director and the editor work together to put it all. I just go and write the book, and the book is taken from my memories and my diary. So, and very often I include things in the book that aren't on film because it was late at night, or we were flying, or the camera was stowed away. So the books, the books I think were really important, and they complemented the film. All the other stuff, yes, there's you could have, in fact the BBC did at one time want to do a sort of interactive thing in the Sahara.
Yeah.
That's them now.
tweet, Michael, tweet now.
Tweet. And what they wanted was, you know, Michael goes somewhere and he's stuck in some part of the Sahara and he has to appeal to the audience. Now, where do I go next? How do I get out of this? Press your buzzers now.
God.
You know, absolutely.
It's a bit Big Brother, isn't it?
It is a bit Big Brother. And really, the great thing about the journeys is you actually travel to get away from home in a way, I mean, and all that, and prepare something which you then take back and show them what your journeys have been. So imagine that if Captain Scott had been shall I go on to the pole or not? Yeah, no, most of them say, yes, go to the pole and take your shoes off as well. So we've knocked that on the head, and we actually haven't changed our technique of making the programmes for 25 years, which is quite rare.
Yeah. Our next clip is actually a little bit about technique, I suppose, really. It's about taking a camera that is a film camera, and now, as cameras have changed, into a very small, high-definition camera, we could film it all on mobile phones or that kind of thing. So we've got a little loop, and perhaps you, the audience, can get involved. And you can say which one you think is HD and which one you think is film. Shall we have a look? We've got that? Is that the next one? I hope it is. Yes. Okay, so there we are. Look, see? Beautiful scenery either side. Which one do you reckon's film? Which one's HD?
Yeah.
That's very confident there. Is he right? On the right, HD left? Okay, who thinks film on the right? It's quite tough. And who thinks film on the left? Well, that's a pretty much film on the right.
Yeah.
And Michael, can you reveal the answer?
Yes, no, it's film on the right. Yeah. That's because that is actually the Dow. That's the famous Dow. Yeah. So that was 1988 we shot that.
Yeah. This just goes around and around for a bit while we talk.
It's quite nice, actually. Yeah, anyway, Nigel, God, it looks like I'm having a good time, doesn't it?
Oh. Take this off.
Cut.
It's quite quiet.
Nigel Meakin was one of the last to stand out for film. And when lots of other people are going for video, he said, no, I can get better contrast on film. We can do more with it. Himalaya was shot on film. I mean, we had to take these rolls of film, you know, the 10-minute mags, very heavy film, and climb right up, you know, the Himalayas with the bloody stuff, and then bring them back down again.
Yep.
But we all believe, you know, Nigel managed to persuade us this was the best, he could produce the best work, and he's won 2 BAFTA awards for his camera work, so one couldn't really...
I think it should stop now, it's slightly driving me mad. Can we make it stop?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Oh, you're powerful, aren't you? Just driving me mad.
Yeah, that's it. I got that.
You can tell me to stop anytime.
No, I'm not going to do that, Michael.
No, please. but anyway, I mean, that. So it was a long time before we actually, I think New Europe, which was shot in 2006, 2007, was the first time he used video. But once converted, he just thinks it's brilliant. But the HD was only Brazil. I don't think New York was in HD.
And presumably, I mean, the one thing about cameras like this, they've just kind of shrunk from film to this. Does that mean the actual physical size of the camera, does that mean you take more?
No, the camera's actually
longer.
Oh,
I just think of mobile phones. I haven't got a clue.
The camera's it's quite big, the old camera that Nigel uses. I'm not
still,
technical, sorry.
Because I wondered that sometimes if you're not tempted to use kind of more than... like take another camera person along with a little camera.
And yeah, we we usually have to had a cameraman and assistant. So assistant would do some work. We weren't able to afford an assistant on the last series. So the director has a little camera which he takes some stuff as well. But Nigel was quite possessive of being cameraman.
It's a good job.
He's bloody good, and he did very very good work. So he wasn't terribly keen on intercutting it with little bits of stuff that was done on a tiny camera. But we did use that, and it can work perfectly well. And things now in the sort of the editing, the digital edit, is just fantastic. I mean, what you can do is just extraordinary.
Yeah, and quick.
And quick, very quick.
I completely lost my question there, so I think maybe... Where's it gone? Did you take it somewhere? It's just gone
it's
away
just
with my
off. Oh,
head.
It's going around Sheffield. Oh, right.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I think it possibly is. I've got to just look down there now. Speaking about things like you're the nicest man in the world, blah, 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 all this kind of stuff, do you ever feel this... I know, sorry, it was because I slightly lost my thread and I've just gone back to the nicest man in the world. Yeah, but
That's so fucking wrong.
I know. Yeah. I wanted to know, there's one thing that travel, it was really horrible downstairs, you know, it was not like that at all. One thing that travel can do is get rid of your niceness. So you are lovely to people, you dance with them, stuff like that, but travel really can get you to the end of your tether. Mm. Are there points when you just think, you know what, I've made the wrong decision, I am going to fly home? And where were they?
I never felt I was going to fly home. I mean, I was always prepared to go on, but it was just times when it's actually not... The people you meet are generally fine. It's actually when things begin to go very wrong. And there was a bit when we were filming in the Amazon, headwaters of the Amazon, and nothing turned up at the right time. We couldn't get a plane out of there. We were going up the headwaters of the Amazon. We'd done most of the filming we could do of sandbanks and all that sort of stuff. And it was just hot and it was sweaty. And I just got very irritated. I said, why are we in this mess? Why haven't we got things sorted out?
And did you shout at somebody? A minion?
Yes. Well, I try not to, but I probably did at one or two occasions. I really hate getting angry because it's a total loss of self-control. It's never productive in any shape or form. And anyone who says it is, you know, they're fooling you. You can criticise, but just to shout and scream is just hopeless. But there were certain moments. I remember we had somebody was driving us. It was when we were in Alaska. We were starting out on Full Circle, and we went with somebody, and we were going to go to a salmon processing plant in near Anchorage, and the PA just didn't really know how to get there. She's a very chatty person, all talking like this, and I don't like people to talk over their shoulder when, you know, they're driving down a road, especially a road in a country they've never seen before. And we're trying to get to a sort of plant and all that. So, I mean, I was kind of thinking, are we nearly there? No, we're not quite. Oh, yes, and it's just so nice, isn't it, to be here? And so great, we've got 10 months to do all this. And suddenly she's turning in, and this huge, great truck coming towards us. Oh, my God. So we skidded to a halt, and we were fine, but just missed. And then I did completely go, absolutely completely go, and I'm not proud of it. And I realised, actually, later, it was partly because I was very, very tired. I'd just finished filming Fierce Creatures, something like that, and literally had two days to get there. I had a cold and all that. So usually it's your own fault. But yes, I did. There was a few choice expletives.
Yeah. I quite like to think about that. I thought that's good.
Yeah, no.
Everybody
no,
loses I, it I, sometimes. Yeah. I've remembered the question. I forgot. Oh, that's good. Zoomed away. Right, it zoomed back into my head. What it is that you are an inveterate note taker, diary maker. Your diaries have been published, and fantastic they are too. And you write all the time, and it's very interesting to see that your life essentially has been recorded. Obviously not your private life, your family life, but essentially your working life is recorded either by you, or it's on Monty Python, or it's, you know, you've got all these essentially kind of memories of these fantastic journeys that have been made into books and films. Is that a lovely thing? Is it slightly daunting? Do you ever look at them, or do you just is it just gone? Because it's like the most detailed photo book of your life that you could ever have.
It's sometimes quite depressing because I think, God, I'm so young. I'm so young in those days. See Python, you know, and there I am with a bit of shaggy hair, long hair. We refuse to have our hair cut on Python. We can't, you know, we look so good with long hair. And I look a complete bloody idiot. But anyway, so apart from that, I think it's great. I mean, it's really, well, when we sort of started off doing Python 1969 and all that, I mean, a television program was on television and that was it. There was no other ancillary form. There were no DVDs or anything like that. Even video had not really come in.
Yeah.
So basically you did your work, made your program and that was it, unless the BBC repeated it. And they didn't even always store things. I mean, Spike Milligan's Q5, which is a very, very funny series, which influenced Python a lot, it was all wiped. Peter Cook and Dudley Moore did a series, not only, but also. Terrifically funny stuff. Half of it was just wiped because they had no storage space for it.
Yeah.
Python was actually among the very first programs that the BBC kept, not because they liked the programs particularly, but they just at that time kept everything. So it's really, I mean, it's great that most things you've done, and one or two things are more embarrassing than others, but it's there. And I like that because you tend to feel at a certain time, I do anyway, oh God, this is not good. The early Pythons, what a mess. They're just not funny. They're not very well put together, not terribly well shot. We should have had time to do a retake here and there. Gloom and doom. And then you see them 20 years later, people look back and say, oh, they're wonderful, these pipes. You look back and it doesn't matter that you actually, that you're, I mean, Spanish Inquisition is a classic example. Yeah. When I come on through that door and say, nobody expects the Spanish Inquisition, and I put my hat back, because just before I went on, I was given this hat, which is a kind of slightly bigger hat than the one I had before, and it came straight down over my eyes. And I remember thinking, this is not going to work. You know, you can't see what I'm doing. So I come in, now nobody expects it, and I keep lifting the hat up. And of course, people think that's great now. You know, that's part of it. Yeah. So I think by having, looking back over a long period and having the works, or so to speak, preserved, you do remember that your attitudes to things change, and you become more fond of things than you were at the time. You become a little less critical, and other things, I suppose, you don't want to see ever again.
But also perhaps that they settle down in a kind of narrative, a historical narrative of British comedy or Britishness as well. I mean, you know, Monty Python was an weirdly, I'm sure for you at the time, became a very brilliant export of Britishness. I mean, a certain type of Britishness out into the world, and so therefore is gained a kind of posterity. Yeah. And that's also, sometimes I think some things you can watch them again, and you enjoy them more. And I think that Python is very much like that.
Yeah.
Do you ever do that though? Do you ever think, you know what? I'm going to have a Python night in. Oh, I'm going to watch myself.
God, no, absolutely.
Or like, I was really, really good at that South Pole.
I'm just going to stay
and watch it.
That's what I don't, and that's why every now and then people put clips together, or you like tonight, and you look at them, and I haven't seen that South Pole thing for a long, long time, and I was actually, gosh, I was quite moved actually seeing it, because it was the end of that very, very long journey, and there was something about it, and the music was quite nice there. It had a slightly elegiac fall to it that actually found quite moving, you know. So if I'd seen that regularly, I suppose I wouldn't quite have the same feeling. So it was quite a surprise. I mean, your mind, you do change your mind about things and what they were like and all that. I mean, some of the ripping yarns, I remember making one of the ripping yarns was about Roger of the Raj, and it starts with this very big country house, and there's the Lord and Lady, the mother and father, sitting at either end of the table. And I'm in the middle, the son, you know, hardly dares say anything. And it's Richard Vernon that brilliant Joan Sanderson. And they're at either side, and they're doing all this dialogue. Toast very good today. Yeah, it is very good, yes. Who made the toast? Oh, I think it was so-and-so. Oh, set her free. What do you mean, set her free? Well, you know, I think she should be free. I haven't had slavery in this country for a long time. Is she free, that girl who was scrubbing the floor? Is she free? Of course she's free. That was so stupid. And don't get emotional in front of the boy, and all things like that. And it was a lovely sequence, and I just, at the time, thought it just didn't work. There was something, the way it was shot and the way we filmed it a certain day. And, you know, I just was quite depressed about that. And then I watched it about 5 years later, and it's just wonderful. I don't quite know what happens. I think you get sort of obsessed by how a product should be absolutely at the time, without realizing that later it does settle, and actually sometimes you have achieved what you think you've not achieved, if you see what I mean.
Yeah, I mean, we've got two clips left, and the last one was going to be a Monty Python one, but given that we started talking slightly Monty Python, maybe should we play the little, I'm getting thumbs up, from, we have a little bit of Monty Python, then I'm going to return to a slightly different topic, if that's all right.
Mm. Yeah, that's all right.
Because I can tell by the fact that you mentioned Monty Python, everyone, so I thought maybe we should do that.
Well, look, quite a bit of travelling on Monty Python, that.
Of three men and one woman whose courage shocked a generation. From the same team that brought you Lawrence of the Morgan, Rick over the River Trent, the man woman of Bigglesworth, and Krakatoa, East of England, comes this story of three people and a woman united by fate who set out in search of the fabled Pole of the Sahara and found themselves.
B. Lieutenant Scott's death struggle with a crazed desert lion.
Now for something completely different.
Now here's a Trivial Pursuit question for you. Which of the pythons was the lion?
I don't. Does anyone know?
Anyone know? All right, hands up, please.
No way. He wouldn't do it.
Hands up, Eric Idle.
Yeah, it could be him, I think.
Yes, that looks pretty good. Hands up, Terry Jones.
I think it might be Terry.
Yeah?
I'm going Terry.
You're Terry Jones?
Yeah.
Oh, you haven't voted twice?
No, so, no.
Hands up, Terry Gilliam, the animator. You're the winners. Yes.
Ah, it's Terry Gilliam.
We always used to get Terry Gilliam to do the really uncomfortable parts.
Poor Terry.
Because he was getting paid and he wasn't acting in the sketches. So he would be the man who... there was a knight in armour in the early Python shows who had a chicken. a raw chicken sort of from Sainsbury's. And he'd just go and bash people on the head with a chicken. And Terry played him. And he played the lion very well. Yeah.
I was convinced when I saw that clip that you'd seen that clip and somewhere, you know, you were making it. Somewhere in your head you thought, I'm going to do that. That's what I'm going to do when I'm older.
Yes.
I'm going to wrestle lions and show my chest.
Yeah, exactly. Had a chest wig, did you notice that?
Yeah, I thought that was real.
No. That was Cliff Richard's chest wig. Lent it to me for the day.
But in your diaries around that time, the thing that strikes you about Monty Python is that it was, you were all quite unsure a lot of the time. So you note down.
Well,
that
I was, yeah. I don't know about the others.
Well, I mean, even, you know, John Cleese would say he doesn't want to do another series, he's only going to film for 3 days. You made your first film didn't make very much money, although you were convinced it was going to, so you all sort of thought, oh, we better start doing it again. Yeah. It was very, you were actually, although you enjoyed doing it, rather less confident than I kind of thought you were about it.
Yes, that's true. I mean, Python was not, it's unrecognisable what's happened to Python, you know, after it, in the last 10 years. From the early years when we made the programme, because the BBC didn't really support it much. It was went out very late at night. We knew we had an audience of sort of undergraduates, people like that, but it wasn't a big audience. We weren't getting major audience figures. We weren't being paid very much, and we were all. I mean, it wasn't just a sort of not funny thing we did. It was our job, you know. And I had family, I had kids to sort of raise and all that sort of thing. So. It was quite a difficult time. How long did we persist with this Python thing? Or should we go off and do, you know, get parts in movies where they'll pay you a lot of money? But I think I'm glad we did carry on. But then very soon after, it was after about 69 we did the first series, 72 John was wanting to go.
Yeah.
And, I mean, nowadays people look back and say, why are you doing Monty Python? Why don't you just make it for the whole of your life? You know, it's just so popular. But I think we did feel we were repeating ourselves. We did feel we weren't having as much fun writing it. And I suppose rather sort of recklessly but bravely, we said, oh, well, let's let's skip it. And we all went off to do other things. And we came back to do the movies, of course, which was, that's unusual. And yeah. That was our saver.
But it's also, I mean, I think quite often if you leave, you know, when people want more, then those things are treasured.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I mean, Fawlty Towers is a
classic.
Perfect example. I think there's only 12 programmes. That's true. I mean, I think we could only do Python when we were enjoying it.
Yeah.
And if we stopped enjoying it, it just became a sort of industrial process. It wasn't gonna work.
Yeah.
Anyway,
I just wanted to say that I will be saying to all you lot out here for asking you for your questions in a bit. I just wanted to do, before we do that, it'll be about 5 minutes. So get your questions ready. I'm just saying that. Do some work. Okay. Before we do that, I just wanted to, we do have one more clip, which is a bit of a weird clip, and I hope you're all going to go with it. But it's Michael talking to another TV travel presenter. So see what you make of this.
And you get these amazing sort of lakes, which are beautiful. Yeah, nice and cool. Anyway,
well, this is your book. That's why you're here, isn't it?
Books. You've got a book.
I've got a book out.
What does your book feel like?
I feel
that's
like
nice. Nice. Oh, God.
Quite weighty, isn't it?
A rude cover, isn't it?
I look all right, though, for my age.
And what did your partner or wife think of that?
She just...
Is that glamorous?
She's sort of a bit, does that have to be the cover? But, you know, we've all changed. I mean, I know my body's not what it was when I first met her, but, you know, hers isn't either. There's about 120,000 words, I think.
Yeah, gosh. Well, there's only 80,000 in that. 90,000, really? Yeah. 120,000 words, all different. Who's that guy?
He was... He was in Russia, and he's magnetic, magnet man.
Oh, what he's got, so full of polluted...
Well, I don't know. At first, I was sort of amazed and a bit like, bloody hell, a magnet man.
Yeah.
But after a while, he was rubbing spoons on himself and he stuck them on me. And I realised he's not magnet man, he's just sweaty man.
Yeah.
his superpower could have sort of been killed with talc.
That's a good sweaty man, is it?
Anyway, we've got books out. I don't know how much we can say about having a book out. There's your book. Good luck with that.
I'll put that in the toilet as soon as I get home.
Good, isn't it?
Now, I included that because you are, if you watch any longer of that, actually, Michael, you're very, very patient with Carl. Carl is quite deliberately unadventurous. He's the most unadventurous man who is then forced to go on adventures. He doesn't want to meet anybody. He goes to Machu Picchu and he thinks it's boring. I mean, there's a kind of... he's like the anti-you, almost. And his programmes are incredibly enjoyable. And I wondered if, post-you, there have been lots and lots of different kind of travelogues, and I wondered if his is almost the epitome of the only way that we can go now is to send somebody out who doesn't actually want to travel.
Well, I mean, I did find it quite odd. We didn't know each other, but we met up and actually got on extremely well, because he's a very funny man, nice guy. And I couldn't quite work out whether he was, you know, manipulated totally by Ricky and Stephen Merchant to do these things, whether he really just would have wanted to stay at home and be the recording engineer he was, or whether actually he quite enjoyed travelling, but it was a kind of way of doing this. I couldn't quite work him out. I thought, how can you go around the world and really and hate it? I mean, it's quite depressing. I mean, there are depressing moments when you travel, but basically, I love it, you know, just the kind of the sun on a new sort of Grand Canyon in the morning or whatever, something like that, or even, you know, Victoria Falls, whatever. It's just terrific, just the excitement, the whole excitement of the thing, the adventure of it. And it seems such a waste of time to go off and do it and not like it. So I think it might, a bit of both. I think I've got a feeling he quite enjoyed going to places, but he had this sort of cantankerous, rather irascible, sort of unimpressed view, which is his humour, and it's very, very funny.
But at one point,
if he were positive, if he were going around like me, it just wouldn't work. But he's very, very funny at talking about, you know, how awful it is, and I can't bear that and all that. And he, I remember him saying, you know, he said I couldn't. We're talking about toilets a lot because he's quite into that. And I said, I think it's just wonderful. You go around the world and you have to get used to the fact that there are no toilets in places. And you just, you know, you've got to squat. And that's people, most of the world, 80% of the world probably do squat. And he said, oh, I can't, I'm never squatting. I just said, I tried it at home. I put these newspapers down in the toilet, but near the toilet, and I'm saying, I'm not doing this, I'm not doing that, I'm not doing that. So, and yeah, very, very funny. It's like a good comic rap.
Yeah.
But I think he has a sort of programmed view of travelling.
But it's actually,
whereas for me, it's just, I'd love to keep the surprise element and the wonder of it all.
And also, you like people, so when you're out there, you're constantly kind of, your faith in people constantly seems to be reaffirmed, whereas he's slightly suspicious of people, so his suspicion is constantly reaffirmed.
Yes,
perhaps.
And his suspicion of people is what's funny, you know, what he's eating.
Yeah.
I mean, I can eat maggots, and I did, you know, stuff like that, and eat strange things. And I go, oh, this is quite good. My automatic reaction is to say, well, this isn't bad at all. Because I think it's rather sort of, you go around saying, oh, this is horrible, the food's horrible, the place is horrible, the people don't speak the language. You're rather missing out. But on the other hand, he gets away with it because he does it extremely funnily. Yeah. Made me laugh a lot.
Which kind of post-you travellers on television do you enjoy? I mean, there's been a lot, you know, whether it's Ewan McGregor on a motorbike, or, you know, Paul Merton goes out there, or, you know, Stephen Fry. A lot of kind of ex-comedians do it, don't they?
Yes. It's the comedian's graveyard travel program. Now, I remember once, actually, I had dinner in 1992. Just after Pole to Pole, and Hugh Laurie and Stephen Fry were there, and they said, God, we really envy you doing that travel. That was great. How do you do that? You know, I mean, we'd love to do something like that. And I said, well, you should do it. And they said, but we've got to do this, and we've got the Worcester series and all that. I said, no, well, you've just got to, for 2 years, you've got to just do that. You've got to be prepared to do the travel and the book and forget everything else. And they just obviously couldn't do that. There was so much in demand to do other things. And I think the really important thing is you have to really, really throw yourself into it. And it can't be just something that you rush back to do a series of QI or whatever that Stephen does. So I think that's one reason why doesn't always work, I think, with ex-comedians doing it. I think Simon Reeve is very good.
Yeah.
He's really, and they're very, very well shot. He covers stories very well. He's got a nice attitude.
Yeah.
I think he's
given
he's
that you have to give kind of 2 years to your life, because one of the things I notice, because I'm female, is that there are not many women that do it, and I wonder if that's because they feel they can't leave the kids, or I don't really know, but it's. And the other factor, I've done a little bit of travel presenting myself, is that sometimes when you're in certain situations as a female, you're not allowed in. So I've been in situations in the Lebanon where you cover yourself as much as you want, and they just won't let you in. And I wondered if that's perhaps as a
factor. I mean, a good example is that we had with our crew of six, the PA when we did the Dow was Angela. She's great. And she so wanted to come on the trip, and they just actually said, the crew don't really want you to come.
Yeah.
It was as simple as that. They said they would feel very uncomfortable having a woman on board. And it wasn't just that, you know, there's an open toilet and there's nowhere to hide. That doesn't really matter. It turned out in the end, it's considered bad luck. All the people who sail the dhows are the men folk. No, I mean, you know,
generally being, I know you laugh, bad luck.
You laugh, and I know, you know, it's not true, but although, you know. No, I mean, that was a case in point where she would not have been allowed, and no presenter would have been allowed to do that really interesting journey. So there's part of that. But then I think back to some of the great travellers of the start of the 20th century, and late Victorian travellers were women travellers.
Yeah.
And they went off to... They travelled as Arab boys, you know, dressed as boys and all that time, and incredibly brave. And so there's some really, really four or five great women travellers at that time.
Yeah.
But I suppose they just had to be pretend to be men. I mean, there was, well, Jo Lumley does a bit.
Yeah.
She goes striding off.
Yeah, looking fabulous.
I don't think anyone would ever refuse Jo Lumley to come on the Dow.
No.
What do you mean? What are you talking about?
Yeah, she'll be there. I've got... I'm going to open it up to you lot. I presume that there's somebody with some mics. But I just wanted to... Just before that, we have our mic, but that's ours. I think there's people...
Oh,
mic.
Yes, I know.
Just
that's
before
ours.
You...
This is our water, too, so it's not really
I'm lost. Just before that, I just wondered if there was anywhere in the world that you wouldn't go because you perhaps didn't agree with it politically, or you covered a lot of the globe, but did you ever think of somewhere and think, you know what, I'm not that happy about going there?
No, I'd go anywhere, I think. And I think it's quite important to go to countries where you have, where there are problems or the things you think you might not like to see. I mean, the South Africa and apartheid was quite an example at the time. Now, I don't know, I think I went there just before apartheid ended, and I'm really glad that I did see it, and I saw it in action, because it's a horrible, horrible system. And to actually see somewhere saying, this park is only for coloured people, this park is only for sort of blacks, this is only for whites. I mean, I'm in a sense, I wish it hadn't happened, but I'm glad I actually saw that.
And particularly at the end of it, that's quite, quite reassuring it's not still there.
Yeah, I mean, it was still sort of, there was sort of vestiges of it, but the answer is I'd go anywhere, because I think it's very, very important. Great thing about travel is you do try and see for yourself, and I think it's really, really important to have your own view and not accept somebody else's. However good they may be, it really is, in the end, best to find out for yourself.
Yeah, okay, great. So where are the mic people? I can't really see, sorry. Oh, there's one, hello. Who would like to put their hands up and ask questions? You were really fast. That gentleman there in the check shirt was so fast that I think he should be given an award for his arm action. And the microphone.
Good evening, Mr. Ottershaw. In these days of inflated transfer fees, I just wondered how much do you think Neville Davitt would have been worth today?
Oh, Neville. Well, he had certain problems, I think, Neville, in the area of his wig. And I think that might have been a bit of a problem. So I think that would have cut it down, probably. Probably, yes. Well, Wayne certainly sort of dealt with it, but I don't think he would have. Davitt would have had the money. So I think probably his price would have gone down from £20 to about 15. Golden Gordon, anyone? Anyone know what we're talking about?
Yeah.
Oh, right. Oh, there are one or two.
Yeah. Getting applause.
Eight bloody one. Yeah. Based on Sheffield United.
Yes, another question. I'm going to go from this side now. Who's got the mic? You've got the mic up there. Okay, I saw this lady here. Well, she's really chuffed.
We can probably hear you from there, but yeah. Here it comes, the great moment.
Hello.
Hello.
This might be a difficult one, but I was wondering, since you've been doing so many things and been to so many places and seen so many people, that if there's something you've done that you're most proud of.
Oh, you mean in the travel sense or whatever? Or
in
just
your
generally?
Career, in your life? I was just curious to know.
Well, I mean, I think that... I suppose it would... I mean, this is sort of rather general thing, but travelling to very remote parts of the world and countries which are completely off the radar because they're so poor that people don't really know anything about them, and to be able to bring them to life on television. I feel quite proud of that. For instance, when we were doing Sahara, I mean, people were going to Niger, which is a country, I mean, nobody knows about Niger. It's about that. It's about one of the three poorest countries in the world. And yet we got sort of 6.5 million people watching Niger and seeing the oasis there and seeing it where they weren't all poor and there was, you know, the music that was there and all that sort of thing. I felt very proud of that. I'm proud, I suppose, that the team had got there, that we managed to get some footage and that we managed to persuade so many people to watch, because I do think we are ignorant about a lot of the world and we tend to have snap judgments about places, and some places we just forget and we say, oh, they're poor and how tragic it is, and give some money to charity. And yet, I mean, nothing wrong with that, but to bring the place to life and to show it's not just a sort of a statistic at the bottom of the world's poorest countries league, that there's actually things going on there. That made me feel very proud, actually. Niger particularly.
Quite right. Yes, I'm going to go from this side now, and I'm going for that lady there. Is that you? Are you a lady or a gentleman? I can't see. We need these lights up. I need to see the audience.
Yes,
I
let's put
see
the
them.
Lights up. Let's see.
See who's
how
talking to us.
Attractive you are. Oh. Actually, down a bit.
Hi. I'm just wondering.
Can you put your hand
up?
I can't quite see where you are.
Wave.
Oh, hello. Yes, right. Yeah. Got you.
If your wife wanted to go to, say, Victoria Falls, would you actually turn around and say, no, darling, it's not really your type of scene? Or would you go with her and say, well, you must look at this, and you must look at that, and you must look at...
Yeah. Yes, I would. Oh, yeah. 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 No, I mean, I've been quite lucky that my wife actually she's not tempted by adventure travel. Long treks across the Himalayas don't really interest her at all. She's very happy staying at home and running the house extremely well while I'm away. So it hasn't really been a great problem, but I think it would have been if she'd been a sort of really intrepid traveller and really wanted to go to places, it would have been quite difficult for me to just go off like that. I'm sure she wouldn't have stopped me, but it would have made things much more awkward. But generally, she just was quite happy for me to go, and I would love to show her Victoria Falls and all that, but you know, I don't want to force her or anything like that. And people always say, well, you take your family come along at any points in the journey? And really, it's not possible. It's like, and my wife puts it very well when people ask her that. So, do you go with your husband? You know, do you miss him? She said, no, it's a bit like, you know, going to the bank with your husband's a bank manager and just sitting there watching him sign checks. It is. That's really, you know, we're doing our work. And actually, families don't kind of fit into that. But, yeah, it's a fair point. I would love to show her parts of the world that I've seen, but she doesn't seem to be very curious.
Okay, well, I'm going to go back to this somewhere over here. Yes, gentleman in a traveller's hat.
This is going to be a difficult one, I know.
I know
it's going to be difficult. He's on a horse, for God's sake. This is going to be really... How did you smuggle that in?
Michael, first of all, I want to thank you because I was a kid when Around the World in 80 Days came on the screen. I was about 9 years old. And I remember thinking at the time, why don't you go to every country without flying? Why don't you go to every single one? Why are you just going around the world? And I kept this with me all my life, thinking that it was possible to do this. And on the January the 1st, 2009, I set out from Uruguay in South America on this epic journey, which I thought was going to take maybe 12 months, maybe 18 months, ended up taking me 4 years.
Oh,
I'm the first person to visit every country in the world.
Oh,
without
well.
Flying.
How you feel?
I stand to you.
Very good.
And now Sheffield, you know.
It feels
wonderful. Is this the high point of all your journey?
Yes, it is actually. But you see, I've been to 201 countries and about 20 territories, but there's still loads of places that I still want to go. And you're a little bit older than me, and I just wanted to ask, is there anywhere left on your wish list? Anywhere that you really want to go to and you haven't made it there yet?
Yeah, I mean, lots of places. So you rightly say, you know, you've seen 201 countries, but I mean, I've seen about 100 countries. Many of them, I could say I've seen just a tiny bit of it. I'd love to go back. You know, you can't say, I've been to Russia. I've been to a couple of bits of Russia, but there's much more to see there. So, I mean, there are the countries I've already visited I'd love to see more of. But the Middle East I've never really travelled in at all, and I think that would be fascinating. Iran, Iraq, you know, where the old civilizations, the first civilizations were sort of were created, Mesopotamia and all that. So I'd love to go there. I've not been there. I've not been to any of the Stans, you know, southern Russia. All these places you presumably know very well. South Sea Islands. I'm rather hoping one day I can persuade my wife to let me go to the South Sea Islands, you know.
If you do, if you have a place like that in mind, and would you have to kind of pitch it, or are you allowed to kind of rock up to the BBC and go, I am going to the South Sea Islands?
No, I mean, you have to go. And I mean, with Brazil, I had to go and pitch it, and they weren't very responsive to start with. They said, why Brazil? Yeah, fair enough, fair question. No, it's not just a question of saying I'd like to go there, but I think I'd make out a case. The BBC have been pretty supportive on the whole, and if I wanted to go to Iran, for instance, which I'd love to go to, I think you could make a case for that, but would it be one programme, would it be four programmes? This is another thing, you know, I feel, in a sense, as you might, that it skated across the surface a bit. We could have done 10 programmes about Brazil and really looked in detail at places. The Himalaya could have been a 20-part series. It's just such a fascinating part of the world. So, in a sense, it's not so much where you're going, it's how you're going to go, how long you're going to go for, what kind of commitment you'll have to the place.
Yeah.
So I would rather, in future, do a place and look at it in more detail than go to on a very, very long journey and just move through a lot of countries in a short time.
Okay. Another question. Yo. Yeah, you're waving at me. I feel like a kind of god.
Yes,
you.
Bomb. Vulcan.
I think maybe you should do it.
He'd be like Vulcan, who's on top of the town hall, isn't he? Vulcan. Yeah, the god of steel.
Yeah. Boom. Yeah, he'll come down and ask you a question.
Mobile phone. Table. Sorry.
Good evening, Michael.
Continue.
Sheffield was recently voted the happiest place to live in the country.
Was it? Sheffield was?
Yeah, Sheffield was,
What, by the Sheffield Star?
I just wondered if you had any theories on why this is, and do you think there might be a documentary in there somewhere?
That would spoil it, wouldn't it, the documentary? Well, I mean, I always feel one thing about Sheffield is its location. It's set amongst all the hills. It's not a huge city, but it's big enough to have a real presence and a real strength. You know, got lots going on. But, you know, the picture and the golden frame and all that. It's very, very important what surrounds Sheffield. Also, I think the fact it hasn't got the sort of the fear factor of having to be the second or third city, like, you know, Manchester and Birmingham always fighting it out, which is the next big city, it's got to be bigger than this. Sheffield's a little calmer. And I also think that the people of Sheffield, just this is my own view, is that they have stroppy in a good way, you know. They're not going to be told to look smart and do this and do that. You know, we'll do it our way, love, you know, and all that. I think that's admirable. So because I always felt when I was in Sheffield that people are doing these, when I was growing up here, doing these terrible jobs in the steelworks and you know, it must be unhealthy and difficult. And yet, when I went to, my father worked for a steel company, and I went in on the shop floor then, and it was all jokes and laughter. And, you know, these were guys who refused to wear hard hats because they wear flat hats, you know. Well, they're, you know, pouring vast amounts of molten steel off a commercial. They just wear their flat hats, having a joke about it and all that. So there was something there in the spirit, and I hope that's still part of that underlies a sort of nice, independent, but comfortable streak about Sheffield and Sheffielders.
Very good. Well, okay. You.
Right, the question was, where did I learn my interest in steam railways? Well, I was always keen on railways. My father actually brainwashed me because he was very keen on railways. And I can't remember when I was quite young, he just, you know, the idea of seeing a steam engine full charging up, you know, out of the door in Totley Tunnel or something like that. I remember him taking me to see these things, and that was a wonderful thing. Also, at school, train spotting was a very much a competitive thing.
Wasn't it?
Blokes, oh yeah, yeah, train spotting. Yeah, absolutely. There wasn't much else to do, love, you know. Go down to Midland Station and platform five.
How did it get competitive? Just, like, who saw it first?
No. Well, how many you'd seen.
Oh, I see.
I mean, there were lots of steam locomotives, you know, and if you were there, if you managed to go 7 days a week, you'd see a lot more, and you underlined them, and that was called a cop.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's a whole new world to me.
I'll tell you what, afterwards, we're going to have... I'll take you down to the station. I'll show you where I used to stand. No, so I suppose it was my dad that got me interested, and I just... I learnt a lot from... this. Yeah, or go to sleep while we do that. From railway engines coming through Sheffield, because the Jubilee class of the main named engines that came through Sheffield, and they're all named after bits of the British Empire. So, you know, you place like Gwalior and Bechuanaland on the side of these dirty old engines. And so I learned a bit of geography and travel at the same time as I watched them come through. But you know, it started quite early on, and I mean, I'm not a total sort of, I'm not a steam enthusiast now. I like to see a steam train. I'm glad they're preserved, some of them, but, you know, it's not quite the same with the new engines.
Oh, he's moved on. Anyway, we'll move on for the engines.
I can go on if you like.
I want to take somebody from the back because I feel like I can't see them very well. So you're as far as I can see, really. Yes, you. Yeah, you.
Yeah.
Hang on, do you want to wait for the mic or have you got a loud voice? No, wait.
Comedian, eh? Yeah. It's Carl Pilkington. With a wig.
Are there, like, any travel documentaries which you watch, like, perhaps inspired you to go to certain places?
Yeah, you've been cheating.
Yeah. Not specifically, no. I mean, I like to think I've made the decision just based on a kind of instinct of my own, or talking to a director, or even reading a book, or whatever. But I mean, there's a guy called Bruce Parry who does some rather wonderful documentaries, and I remember seeing, you know, his tribe and all that sort of stuff, and thinking, yeah, actually that's kind of quite some interesting insights into the places he went. And it goes back to what I was saying earlier about doing things in more detail. He tended to stay in a place and really get under the skin of it. So that wasn't necessarily the place, it was the style in which he travelled, which I thought was quite interesting and appealing. And then, as you know, there's Attenborough, who I know he doesn't do, it's not specifically travel, but he is travelling around the world, see these amazing places. And, I mean, David has the ability to make almost anything interesting. You know, a rock. He can speak about a rock for about 5 minutes. It'll be absolutely fascinating. And you can see it give birth to another little rock. And then, you know, a rock will attack him and he'll sort of be able to deal with it. But, I do think the way his programmes are shot, also, you get the feeling of the wonder of the world, which is what... So it's a great thing for me. What did I see the other day? There was something, a documentary I saw. I think it might have been Werner Herzog did a film about Antarctica. And there was just some stuff in that I thought, gosh, we missed things in Antarctica when we went. He had some lovely stuff about the penguins and all that. Anyway, yeah, I do watch things, but I try not to be influenced by them directly. I like to think I've had the idea myself.
So, look, I have a red light flashing in front of me, which means I can have two more questions. One of which is that man there, because he's really, really keen. And the other one is that man right at the top there, because I think we should go up top again. I'm sorry for everyone else.
Who first?
Bad. That gentleman.
Gentleman over here. Oh. Okay,
really,
so now Miranda's in charge.
It better be a good one now.
Yeah. Your I hope last... it is.
Go on, do you want to go first? Hold the mic a bit close because we can't hear
you. Is the mic on? Can't quite hear it.
No? Shout then.
Shout. I can hear you.
Considering we're living in an era of political correctness and everything has to be so perfect, and we are what they call
interesting.
Oh,
what
well,
a
that's,
great question.
That's a very, amazing. Very good question, yes. Are children today stifled because they have to be perfect? I think maybe they're protected and given a sort of certain healthy dose of, or unhealthy dose of fear about places to go and all that. But on the other hand, I think nowadays people have much more opportunity to find out about the world, get information about the world, opportunity to travel. Is now almost there for almost anybody. You know, you can get a cheap flight, and you can make your own adventure. So I think it's much, much better than it was when I was growing up. It's a really, you can argue the point whether not having the ability to travel makes you enjoy travel so much more when you do it, whereas having the opportunities, albeit slightly sanitized, but having the opportunities, and then suddenly it becomes something quite normal and unexciting. I mean, that's a balance. But I think that in many ways, I quite like to be born now and start on from here, because I think that there are just more opportunities for people of a certain age, younger people, to travel and to see the world. And I think that's probably, on balance, a good thing.
Maybe especially because they can't get a job, so they could just
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, well, that's, that's a fair point. And I think that Monty Python probably would not have been commissioned nowadays. Partly because they'd want to have a description of what we were going to do, and we couldn't really tell them. And if we could, it'd be like, Spike Milligan and the Goons. What are you going to do? We're going to have a lot of people talking in voices like this. Who's going to give you a series from that? So the BBC were adventurous at that time. They were also very powerful. And there was very little competition for the BBC. And they could, indulge themselves. They put on Python late on a Saturday night. We paid them very little, but we won't, let them do 13 shows and we'll ignore them. And it gave us the chance to sort of create something out of those shows. I think nowadays you'd have to, give a big job description. Also, I think that the BBC are more nervous now about, what they say and how they say it. There are far more rules and regulations about how you put the information out there. But then, they've got the politicians, they've got people, having a go at the BBC, left, right and centre, saying, licence fee and all that, hump, hump, hump. Whereas, in fact, the licence fee is extremely reasonable compared to what you pay for Sky, for a month or something like that. So there's a lot of pressure now, and I don't think it's partly political correctness. It's partly just that I think the whole thing has become much more commercial. Television production is now like selling toilet paper. That's what it is. You're producing a product, and you've got to be aware of that all the time. And that's why I think in documentaries nowadays, you tend to get this tendency to sell the program before the program's even started. You'll have a documentary, in the first 3 minutes, they've got to tell you exactly what you're going to see in the next hour. I mean, the idea of just beginning a documentary and then letting it unfold, they don't really like that nowadays. Everything's got to be pre-sold, like toothpaste, and I think that is a pity.
Yeah, very much so. You've got to have your question. You've got the mic ready. It's so ready. It's a final question.
Yeah, it was actually that last one, but
I was it? Yeah. Very good. Yeah, well, you better get together.
I've got another one for you, and that's the your time on the Dow had a huge influence, I believe, on you, and you went back some 20 years later to revisit those guys.
Yes.
Is there anybody that you've met that you would like to go back and revisit?
Yes. There's quite a lot of people. This is again something I regret about the nature of the programs I make, is that you have to get to know people very quickly. And I enjoy people, I enjoy talking to people, I have no problem with that. But you have to become in order to try and get an interview with them and produce something, you're very often in that place for a day, or even half a day, or even a couple of hours. And so you have a kind of intimacy with them, you don't want them to answer great questions about the environment and all that. You just want them to be friendly and offer you a drink and things like that and see how how they react together. And then you go on, and that's it, sorry. And they're generally saying, oh, well, we'll sit down, let's all have another drink. So there have been various places where I feel I've got out of there far too quickly. There was a Tibetan, a yak herder, and he was really nice, and he knew we were going to come and film him doing a bit of yak herding, and he put his suit on, you know. So that was I looking a real mess, and he was in this rather sharp suit with the labels on the outside, which is a fashionable thing in China. And you know, we had a lovely little encounter. We went inside his tent, and his wife was making the butter with a big churn, and the children were there. And, you know, snotty-nosed children, just like children everywhere. And it was just lovely. And we sat, and neither of us could understand what either side were talking about. And yet there was a sort of rapport. I knew exactly how the children were. And there's always one of them that's trying to be very nice and suck up to daddy, and the other one is whinging away. You know, you see that. I see that with my own kids. I see that with my grandsons and all that. And that was such a lovely moment. And then suddenly, sorry, time, we've got to get the train or we've got to get the bus on. And you're waving goodbye to this guy, and he got his suit on, he had his bike ready. And so, yes, there are many, many people like that I would love to go back to.
Envisage making another programme, visiting anywhere else like that?
What?
Do you think you will ever make another programme like you went back to the guys on the Dow?
Going back to see... I'm not sure. I have this fantasy that I would like to get all the people who've helped me on all my journeys into the Albert Hall and give them a really good party. They keep the yaks in Kensington Gardens.
And on that really lovely image, I'm afraid we have to stop because the light is definitely flashed and they're coming down to take the mics off us and they're really cross because we've overrun.
Oh, yes.
But that is
here's
because,
the next
look, they're
speaker.
Literally coming to take us off the stage.
Yep.
But I'd like to say thank you very much for being such a lovely audience and thank you to the fabulous Michael.
Thank you. Perry. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
I love your audience.
Oops. Oh.